So, what is the power set? Power set is a set denoted by P of S. It is a set of subset of S. That is, we can just define P of S equal to nothing but 2 to the power, we can call as a cardinality of 2 to the power of S. Suppose, we can use here a set containing the three elements A, B and C. Now, what is a power set? So, power set is nothing but the cardinality is total number of three elements, it is 2 to the power 3, which is equal to 8 elements, we can consider a power set. So these are the, first is the null set, then A, then B, then C, then we can take combination of AB, then BC, then AC, and then A, B and C. So total number of combination is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So, the power set of a set S denoted P of S is a set of all subset of set S. So here, in a set A, we can consist of three elements. So total number of power set we can consist as a 2 to the power of N. That is, N is nothing but number of elements in a set. So here we can take one example in which you can find the P of A equal to total number of its sets. Similarly, the empty set and the set itself are always element of the power set. So suppose we can say, what is the empty set? Empty set can contain only null set. And what is the subset of this empty set? We can consist of the phi and curly of phi. That is nothing but we can take, if suppose it is consist of one element, then we can take the power set. How many number of element? It is nothing but 2 to the power 1. That is two element, phi and curly brace of phi. So, now, the power set is a fundamental combination of the objects when considering all the possible combination of element of the set. So here, the S be a set such that mod of S equal to N, then we can take P of S equal to 2 to the power of N. So it is nothing but we can take P of S in mod, which is 2 to the power of N, where N is nothing but number of element in set. So, sometimes we need to consider the ordered collection of the objects. So, the ordered n tuples we can take a1, a2, a3 up to an, and the another order we can take a b1, b2, b3 up to bn. So, when we can say both are ordered pair, we can say ai, bi, where ai should be appear first before the bi. So, here the two ordered n tuples are equal if and only if we can say ai equals to B of I. Then we can say both the tuples are equals. So if the suppose the n tuple value is true, then we can take it two ordered pair tuples, and the ordered pair means the sequencing in which the first element occurrence is AI, then after the occurrence of BI. If suppose the order will be different, if suppose BI and AI, AI we can say A1 comma B1 should not be equal to B1 comma A1. So ordered pair means that is the first occurrence of the element is A1, then occurrence of the B1. And if both the value will be same, then we can say there is no matter A1 occurrence first or B1 occurrence first. Suppose for example 1,1 equal to 1,1, either 1 should become first or at the last. If suppose 1,2 and 1 is nothing but the value of A and 2 is the value of B, and we can say it is 2,1, it is not equal to. So the meaning is that if AI equal to BI, then we can say both the ordered pair are equal. If suppose the both the element contain the same value, then the order doesn't matter. Otherwise, the first element should be occur, that is AI, then occur BI. And if suppose first occur BI, then occur AI, both are the different ordered pair. So now, the next is the, what is the Cartesian product of the set? So, in a Cartesian product of the set, we say that A cross B, which is equal to A comma B, such that A is a member of A conjunction or and B is a member of B. So, this A, first element, it is a member of set A, and second, the one pair, second element is B, which is a member of B. And these the conjunction operation is called as a Cartesian product of A cross B. So if A and B are the two set, the Cartesian product of A and B is denoted by the A cross B and is a set of all ordered pair which is belonging to first order, first element belonging to set A and second element belonging to the set B. One important thing you have to remember in your mind, A cross B not equal to B cross A, unless we can say A equal to 5 or B equal to 5, or we can say the element of set A which is equal to element of set B. Other than that case, we can say A cross B not equal to the B cross of A. So Cartesian product can be generalized for the n tuples. So the Cartesian product of the n set, we can consist only same set A1 into A2 into A2 up to AN. So we can just find A1 cross A2 cross A3 up to AN. So it should be represented in the such a way that A1 comma A2 up to AN, such that AI is a member of capital AN, where I equal to starting from 1, 2, 3 and so on. So because it is consist only a single set, and we can multiply A1 set to A2, A2 set to A3 and so on. So the result will be generated as A1 comma A2 up to AN, such that AI is a member of AN, where I equal to 1 to N. So there really are not a way to represent the infinite set by a computer, because since computer have a finite memory. So if we assume that universal set is a finite, then we can easily and effectively represent sets by the bit vector. In bit vector, we can say, if it is generally we can say in the form of Boolean algebra, where the value truth value should be true, it should be generated 1. If it is value false, it becomes generated as a 0. So specifically, an ordering of the object in such a way that universal set equal to A1, A2, A3 up to AN, and A is subset of universal set, so BI, that is a bit vector of equal to 0, if AI is the element of set A, is not a member of set A, and BI equal to 1 if AI is a member of set A. If there is a consistent element of set A is present, then we can take bit vector as a 1. If it is not element present in the set A, then we can say the bit value become 0. So with the example, we can prove that how to find out the bit vector concept. So it is simply like that. It is the value we have to taken in this example, the U equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That is a universal set, and set A value equal to 0, 1, 6, 7. So what is the value of bit vector A? So bit vector A value we can generate with the help of this universal set. And as we know what the universal set says, BI equal to 0 if AI is not a member of A, and BI equal to 1 if AI is a member of A. So here the AI is a member of A is only 4 element 0, 1, 6, 7. So we can represent in the form of bit vector, that is equal to 0, it will be 1, 1, it is 1, because 1 is present in the universal set, 0 also present in the universal set. But 2 is not present in the set A, but it is present in the universal set, that's why we can say it is 0. 3 is also not present, we can say 0. 4 is also not present, we can say bit value is 0, because here is not a member of set A. So it is a 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now 5 is not present, we can again 0. 6 is present, and 6 here also present. So what the value will be have to bit vector? The value become 1. So now 7 is present in the element of set A, which is also universal set, we can take this one. So that is the bit vector value 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1. So in a computer, there is a finite memory, how to represent the finite set with the help of bit vector. So bit vector definition says that if it is 0, when it is not the element of set A. So it is not an element of set A, then the we can corresponding value become 0, and if it is an element of set A, then we can corresponding value become 1. So that is the way in which we have to describe the what is the value of set value. Now the set operation become trivial when set are represented by the bit vector. So union is obtained here. One, the important thing is that union can be obtained with the help of bitwise OR, and intersection can be obtained with the help of bitwise AND. So it is just operation we have to discuss in the case of first year C programming, what is the bitwise operator. So bitwise AND will be treated as an intersection, and bitwise OR will be treated as a union operation. So now next is the discuss the part of the set partition. So here in a set partition we can say that there is a one universal set U, in that there is a different regions in which we can divide it into the parts. It is called as a A1, A2, A3, A4 and A5, and no region should be overlapped. And the one thing you have to, important thing you have to remember, AI intersection AJ always come occur the null. So both the sets are, both the elements of the sets will be disjoint. So we say the group of set partition another set if they are mutually exclusive and exhaustive with respect to the set. Mutually exclusive means AI intersection AJ equal to null, and exhaustive means we can say earlier A union B equal to equivalent to C is called as exhaustive with respect to the set. Then partition is said to break down into the mutual exclusive and exhaustive region where there is a consist of no overlap. So the mathematically we can define the set partition. If S is a non-empty set and a S partition subdivision into non-overlapping, non-empty subset. We have to take this is a S partition, and this S partition we can divide into the four part A1, A2, A3, A4 and A5. So in this non-empty set, we can divide this S into part of A1, A2, A3, A4 and A5. Now this A1 consists of n number of element, A2 also consists of n number of element, A3 also consists different number of element, but no one can be overlapping. That is one of the important concepts. So a partition of S is a collection of AI of non-empty subsets of S such that each A in set S belong to one of the AI, and the set of AI are mutually disjoint. That is AI intersection AJ equal to 5, and another condition is that AI not equal to AJ. So these are the two condition, mathematical condition we can prove for the set partition. Now the next concept we can discuss here, which is the multiset. So a multiset is the set where we can specify the number of occurrence of each element. If suppose the few elements should be occurrence n number of time, so how we can justify and how to we can perform the operation of union, intersection and difference operations. So we can say the m1.a1, m2.a2 up to mr.ar. What is the meaning of that? That is m1 can be occur in a1 time. m1 occur in a1 time. So that is the way in which we can find out the mr occurring ar number of times. So in database, we distinguish a set is element cannot be repeated, but in a bag element can be repeated. So now where we can use the multiset concept, we can just take even example in which we can more clarify about the what is the utility of the multiset. So before we can take the example, we can discuss in the multiset we can perform different type of operation. First is the union operation. Union of multiset A and B is a multiset where the multiplicity of element is the maximum of its multiplicity of A and B. So that is the perform of A union B. Now the next is the A intersection B is the multiset where the multiplicity of element is minimum of multiplicity in A and B. that is nothing but common element between the A and B. Difference, the A and B is the multiset where the multiplicity of element in A less its multiplicity in B unless the difference is negative. In which case the multiplicity we can say as a 0. And that is called the difference, or we can say A minus B, and the last is the A plus B. Sum of A and B is the multiset where the multiplicity of element is the sum of multiplicity in set A and the set B. Now we can jump to the solving the one problem in which we can more clarify about the how to perform multiset operations. So here the problem is like that: A equal to 3 dot A, 2 dot B, 1 dot C, and the value of B equal to 2 dot A, 3 dot B, the next portion is 4 comma D, 4 point D. So now we can perform the different type of operation, and you can find A union B, A intersection B, A minus B, and A plus B. So what we can do? The meaning of this statement is that it is occurrence 3 number of time the A1 occur, 2 number of time B occur, and 1 number of time C occur. It is 2 number of time A occur, 3 number of time B occur, and 4 number of time D occur. So here we can take one this thing. We can take A should be occur 3 times, B should be occur 2 times, and C should be occur 1 time. Here in this case B, now the A should be occur 2 times, B occur in 3 times, and D occur in 4 times. Now we can find A union B. What is the value of A union B? A union B says the either maximum element of either A or B. So we can take it is the value of A comma A comma A. Here we can consist B comma B comma B. It is C, and D comma D comma D comma B. That is the A union B. Now we can find A intersection P. A intersection B, we say that that is a what is the minimum difference between the here it will become A. Now it is the A comma C. Only one A here. Now it is 2, it is the 3 element is not possible, and only C. So A comma C is the value of A intersection B. Now the third value we can find out, that is called the value of A minus B. So next value we can find A minus B. So now A minus B is, we can say the value of A minus B equal to, if it is consist of the 3 time of A and B should be occur at 2 time. So that is the value of is the A minus B. So A minus B means it is a value occur A, the number of elements should be occur 3, and it is occur 2. So the difference is only 1 A. In B, it is not subtract by A minus B. In C, that is present, so it will be come occur C. So now we can find the A intersection B. In A intersection B, it is 2 times A should be occur, so A comma A. Now B 2 time occurs, it is B comma B. No C time should be common. So that is the common between the A intersection B is A comma A and B comma B. Now we can find the value of A plus B. A plus B, it means all the elements, sum of all the elements of set A and set B. So it should become occur A comma A comma A, that is a 5A and 5B and 1C and 4D. So that is the way in which we can find out the multiset operation, how to perform union, subtraction, intersection, and additional operations. So now, next we can discuss the concept is the few problems we can more discuss here, and that is show that set of even positive is a countable set. So here, that solution is here, we can just do the set of even positive. We can take one number which associated with the even positive minus 2, it may be even positive number, okay. So we can take the number is even positive is 2. Now the 2 we have corresponding with the even positive number 4. Now 3, it is 1 to 1 corresponding with 6. So the 4 value, then number will be corresponding with the 8. Now 6 corresponding with 10 and so on. So here it is a set of natural number n, and it is called as a 2 into n. If suppose when we can take the set of n natural number 1, 2, 3 up to n, now we can, this set of element we can multiply by 2, it will be generate all the set of even number. So that type of set is not the finite set or countable set or uncountable set. So we can say that type of set is called as a countable infinite set. So that type of set is called as a countable, we can just count the countable set in the form of, in the pair of n, 2n, where n is the set of natural number and 2n is the set of even number. So it is called as a countable infinite set. Now another problem is determine whether finite, countable, infinite, uncountable for the following set. Set of even integer. Here the first question, set of even positive integer. So it will be consist of 2, 4, 6, 8. The set of even integer, it may be negative and may be positive. So we can take another problem, the part first. 1 corresponding with minus 2. Now 2 corresponding with 2. 3 corresponding with minus 4. 4 corresponding with 4. And so on. It is also considered, we have to observe that it is a set of natural number we can corresponding 1 to 1 corresponding between the set of natural number to set of even integer. So it is also set, it is called as a countable infinite set. Because it is 1 to 1 correspondence between the set of natural number and the set of even integer. Now the another problem is the set of negative integer. The set of negative integer, again the one natural number we can consist of minus 1, 2 consist of minus 2, 3 consist of 1 to 1 corresponding 3, 4 number consist of minus 4 and so on, 5 consist of minus 5. So every number, natural number, 1 to 1 corresponding with the set of negative integer. So set of negative integer, it is also called as a 1 to 1 correspondence between the natural number and the set of negative integer. That's why it is also called as a countable infinite set. It is called as a countable infinite set. And the another one is the set of integer that multiply by 5. So it is multiply by 5 means it is, the first number should become 5, second 10, third 15, then 20. These all are come along with the set of natural number. It is also called as a countable infinite set. Set of real number between 0 to 0.6. So this is the set of real number between 0 to 1 and 0 to 0.8 or 0 to 0.6. It is called as a uncountable infinite set. So, because we cannot distinguish between 0 to 0.6, how many numbers should we occur? So, the set of even number, real number between 0 to 0.6, it is called as a uncountable infinite set. And the set of all the three on earth, this is a finite set, even though the number is so large, but we can count it. That's why it is called as a finite set, where set of all three on the earth. Now the next problem is, if the set X has 10 members, how many members do P of X has? So P of X has, total number of members is nothing but, we can take as a P of X equal to 2 to the power 10. Now, in how many members of P of X as a proper subset of X? In a proper subset of X, we can exclude the original number of set elements. So, here in the previous case, we can just discuss if a set containing 3 elements, what is the number of, how many number of power set we can consist? we can consist 2 to the power 3 equal to 8 power set. Including that one set is also existing. So we can exclude that set, it is treated as a number of proper subset. So we can just give one example in which we have to more clarify. That is a A equal to, that is a 2 set A comma B. Now we can find a power set which is equal to 5 A B and A comma B. So total number of total element is 4. It is nothing but 2 to the power 2 equal to 4 element. Now what is a proper subset? So proper subset means we can exclude this element, because this is the A set element A comma B. We can exclude this one. So how many number of elements should be existing? We can say 2 to the power 2 minus 1. So same here. So the total number of proper subset we can consist, it is called as a 2 to the power 10 minus 1. That is the total proper subset of X. So only what we can do, we can just exclude this set, that is for the final set that consists the same element in a set A. So now what is a power set and empty set? And what is the power set of set 5? So power set of the empty set is a singleton element. We can say the empty set P of 5 equal to, we can just take as a this one, power set of the empty set we can take as a null set. But what is the power set of set 5? The power set of set 5, that is P of 5, which is equal to 5 comma 5. So that is the difference between, this is treated as a power set and this for the set 5, and it is treated as a power set of the empty set. So the another problem is that so that the intersection of countable infinite number of infinite set may be finite. So you can prove this one. We can take a set A in which we can consist all the element which is 2, the value is 2 and less than 2. So the set element we can consist as a 2 comma 1 comma 0 minus 1 minus 2 and up to n number of element. Now the second thing, we can take n equal to natural number, and the natural number we can consist of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and so on. Both are the, we can call it as a countable infinite number. This A is also countable infinite, n is also countable infinite. Now we can find the A intersection n. A intersection n equal to nothing but 1 comma 2. So what is a 1 comma 2? 1 comma 2 is a finite set. 1 comma 2 is a finite. So what we want to prove, the intersection of the countable infinite numbers of infinite set, it is a countable infinite number of the infinite set may be finite. So when we want to find the intersection, it consists only 1 or 2, because the intersection only this and this number are common. So we can take 1 comma 2, so the intersection will be a finite number. So now we have to just, so this is the regarding problem about the mathematical, the problems of the set theory. Now we can next start the mathematical induction and inclusion exclusion principle. So now next is the mathematical induction, and before we start with the mathematical induction, we can just find out, if suppose the statement is like that n to the power 7 and n is positive integer, and you can find the cardinality of the number. So what we can do, we can just n to the power 7 and n is a positive integer, the number should be occur in the form of 1 to the power 7, 2 to the power 7, 3 to the power 7, 4 to the power 7 and so on. It is also corresponding with the 1, it is corresponding to 2, corresponding to 3, corresponding to 4. It is also called as a countable infinite set. If suppose the problem is like that n to the power 100 and such that n is a positive integer, and you can find the cardinality of the number. So what we can do, it is again 1 to the power 100, 2 to the power 100, 3 to the power 100 and so on, and it is corresponding to the single element 1, 2 and 3. These are the set of even integer. So it is also called as a type of countable infinite problem for countable infinite sets. Now the another problem we can take in a set theory, that is the A union B intersection and the A union B to the power C, which is equal to P. So here what we can do, we can express the right hand side expression, we can find the A. What we can do, we can take a left hand side A union B intersection A union B to the power C. Now we can apply the distributive law, it is called A, and now we can find B intersection, we can just write apply the distributive law. When we can apply the distributive law, it is find A union B intersection B to the power C, and now B intersection B to the power C equal to 5, so A union 5, which is equal to A. So in that way we can also use the different type of theorem to prove the expression. Now the next problem we can discuss, that is called as a mathematical induction. In mathematical induction we can use the two rules, mathematical induction principle 1 and induction 2. So first principle is says, let P be the proposition defined on the positive integer n, n value equal to 1, 2, 3 up to n, and P of n is either true or false for each small n in n, where n is a natural number, n is the 1, 2, 3 n number of value. Suppose P contains two properties. First mathematical induction say it is true for the base value, that is P of 1 is true, or it is true for the base value. If it is true for P of 1, then we can say P of n plus 1 is true whenever P of n is true. So that rule, that two property we have to remember in your mind in the case of mathematical induction proof. Next, the mathematical induction second rule says, let P be the proposition defined on positive integer n such that P of 1 is true, and the second property says P of n is true whenever P of k is true and k lies in between the 1 to n. So P of n is true whenever P of n is true for all k is greater than or equal to 1 and less than n, then P is true for every positive integer. So now we can solve the few problems based on the mathematical induction. So first problem says, prove with mathematical induction the sum of first n odd number is n square. The sum of first n odd number is n square. So it is nothing but 1 plus 3 plus 5 plus 7, these all are the number up to 2n minus 1 equal to n square. That we want to prove. What we can do with the mathematical, with the help of mathematical induction. So first P of 1 is true, we can prove. How? We can take P of 1 equal to 1, which is equal to 1 square, because in left hand side first term is 1, in right hand side n value 1, 1 square, so we can say 1 equal to 1. So here P of 1 is true. So P of 1 is true, then we can find P of n plus 1 is true. So that is what we can do, that is the first property. Second property we can prove from n plus 1. So tell me, what is the n plus 1 term of the odd number? So it is 2n minus 1 is the nth term of the odd value. So the next term is, it is not come 2n because 2n is an even number, so it will become of the 2n plus 1. So we can just take 1 plus 3 plus 5 plus 7 up to 2n minus 1, and n plus 1 term is 2n plus 1. So we can just add 2n plus 1 in both sides. So equal to n square plus 2n plus 1. So here we can find the n plus 1 ka whole square. That is n plus 1 whole square. It is, the value is n square. It is the n plus 1 whole square. So we can say it is true for all n, because p of n plus 1 is true. So it is true for all n with mathematical induction. So that is the proof in which we can only two term we can use the property. One is the base value is true, and second we can prove p of n plus 1 it is true. Then we can say it is true for all the n values. Now the next second problem we can discuss, that is prove the following proposition: for n is greater than or equal to 0, 1 plus 2 plus 2 square up to 2 to the power n equal to 2 n plus 1 minus 1. What we can do? We can prove again p of 1 is true. So p of 1 is true means p of 1, it will be taken as a 1. Now here we can use the mathematical induction second principle, the n value is greater than or equal to 0. So we can take p of 0 which is equal to 1, which is nothing but 2 to the power 0 plus 1 minus 1. So 1 equal to 2 to the power 1 minus 1. 1 equal to 1. So we can say p of 1 is 2. That is the first. Now second, we can take p of n plus 1 is true. So what we can do? We can use the 2 of n plus 1 in both the side, because so now the value become 1 plus 2 plus 2 square and so on. 2n plus 2n plus 1 equal to 2n plus 1 minus 1 plus 2n plus 1. So it is like that, the value we can generate, which is the 2 to the power 2 times n plus 1 minus 1. So that is the value we can generate, 2 to the power n plus 1 plus 2 to the power n plus 1 minus 1. So it is 2 to the power 2 times n plus 1 minus 1. It is called as a, it is true for p of n plus 1 is true for all the value of n. So that the way in which we can find the mathematical induction, we can prove whether it is true for n plus 1. Now the another problem, which is that show that un equal to the value of un equal to 3 to the power n minus 2 to the power n for n equal to, n is a member of n, n is a member of set of natural number, and n is greater than equal to 2, where u1 equal to 1 and u2 equal to 5, and un plus 1 equal to 5 times un minus 6 of un minus 1. So that we have to prove with the help of mathematical induction. So what we can do in that type of proof, we can just take the value of first p1 and p2. So now then we have to solve the expression in the detail. First we can take p of 1, which is equal to 3 to the power 1 minus 2 to the power 1 equal to 1, which is equal to u1, and p2 equal to 3 to the power 2 minus 2 to the power 2 equal to, it is the 9 minus 4, which is equal to 5, which is the u2. Now the next point we can discuss, the un plus 1 equal to 5 times un minus 6 of un minus 1. So here in that case, the value of un equal to 3 to the power n minus 2 to the power n. So what we can do, we can just substitute the value of un in the equation of un plus 1. So what we can get, un plus 1 equal to 5, 3 to the power n minus 2 to the power n minus 6 times 3 to the power n minus 1 minus 2 to the power n minus 1. Because it is a un minus 1, that's why we can term just write as a 3 to the power n minus 1 minus 2 to the power n minus 1. Now the un plus 1 equal to 5, we can just open the bracket, it is 3 to the power n minus 5 into 2 to the power n. Now, one thing you have to remember again, that equation should become in the form of 3 to the power n minus 1. So all the equation we can come under the same term n minus 1. So what we can do, we can just write in the sequencing of same number of repetitions we can not occur. It is come in the form of 5, 3 to the power 1 into 3 to the power n minus 1. So it is nothing but n minus 1 plus 1, it is equal to 3 to the power n minus 2 to the power 1 into 2 to the power n minus 1 minus 6 into 3 to the power n minus 1 2 to the power n minus 1. It is equal to 15 in bracket, we can take 3 to the power n minus 1, it is 15 minus we can take as a 6. Now the next value is minus, we can take 2 to the power n minus 1, here 10 minus minus, it is plus. So now we can just solve it, 5 into 10 and minus, it is 3 to the power n minus 1 minus 2 to the power n minus 1. So it is plus 6. So here it is 3 to the power n minus 1, 15 minus 6, it is 9, minus we can take 2 to the power n minus 1, it is the negative minus 10, and it is also minus minus positive, so it will become under negative sign, because it is the negative negative positive, so it should be, and it is the negative sign, so it will come into the minus. So 10 minus 6, it is occur under 4. So here 3 to the power n minus 1 into 3 to the 3 square minus 2 to the power n minus 1 into 2 square. So it is come under the form of 3 to the power n minus 1 plus 2 minus 2 to the power n minus 1 plus 2, which is equal to 3 to the power n plus 1 minus 2 to the power n plus 1. So that is the value of u n plus 1. So it is true for p of 1 and p of 2. So it is true p of 1 and p of 2 true. Then now we can prove u n plus 1. So p of n plus 1 is true. So what we can do, we can prove, and that equation should be generated if u n equal to 3n minus 2n, then u n plus 1 equal to 3 to the power n plus 1 minus 2 to the power n plus 1. So we can say it is p of n plus 1 is true for every n. So with the help of mathematical induction. So that is the proof in which we have to find out how the equation should be valid with the help of mathematical equation, mathematical induction. So now, next we can discuss the inclusion-exclusion principle. So in inclusion-exclusion principle, we can take the A and B are the two finite sets, and you have to remember this formula, A union B equal to n of A plus n of B minus n of A intersection B. So n of A and n of B are inclusive and A intersection B is exclusive. So that's why it comes under the negative sign. So any finite set, we can take three sets. So we can find A union B union C, which is equal to n of A plus n of B plus n of C minus n A intersection B minus n B intersection C minus n A intersection C plus n of A intersection B intersection C. So that is the way in which we can find out the inclusion-exclusion principle. So that is the problem based on the inclusion-exclusion principle, that is, among the integers 1 to 1000, how many of them are divisible by 3, nor how many of them are not divisible by 3, nor by 5, nor by 7. And another problem is that in the survey on a group of 80 people, it is found that 60 persons like eggs and 30 like fish find the percentage of people like both fish and egg. So that we have to problem solve one by one. First question is that among the integer 1 to 1000, how many of them not divisible by 3, not by 5, and not by 7. So we can solve how to solve this problem. So we can set A, that is number of integer number, or we can say set of integer which is divisible by 3. B is a set of integer which is divisible by 5, and C is a set of integer which is divisible by 7. So now we can find the value of mod A. Mod A equal to 1000 divided by 3, which is equal to 333. Because only we can take mod value, not take the fractional value. Now what is the value of B? B is integer which is divisible by 5. So 1000 divided by 5. 5 to the 10. It is 200. Now we can find the mod C value. It is 1000 divided by 7, which is equal to the approximate value which is you find, that is 142. So now the next we can find what is the value of A intersection B intersection C, which is equal to 1000 upon 3 into 5 into 7. Now we can find the value of A intersection B, B intersection C, and A intersection C. That is A intersection B, that is 3 into 5, B intersection C, that is 1000 divided by 5 into 7, and that is 1000 divided by A into C, that is 3 into 7. And we can generate the value regarding that. What? First value we can find, that is value equal to 9. You can just simplify the expression, and A intersection B, the value become 66. And when we can find the B intersection C value, it is approximate equal to 28, and it is equal to 47. You can just solve it, and you can find this. These are the value. Now we can find out the number of the how many of them are not divisible by 3, not by 5, not by 7. So first of all, we can take the divisible by this one. We can find the n A union B union C, which is equal to n of A plus n of B plus n of C minus n A intersection B, n B intersection C minus n A intersection C plus n of A intersection B intersection C. So we can just substitute the value of this one, and we can find the n of A union B union C. So it is, the value is like that: n of A 333 plus n of B, it is 200, plus 142 minus A intersection B 66 minus 28 minus 47 plus 9. The value become, you can just simplify the expression, and the value become generate as a, that value should be generated, which is equal to 543. You can just expression solve, and you can find out the value become 543. Now what we can do, the set of number that are not divisible by 3, not by 5, and not by 7. So what we can find, we can just find out the A bar intersection B bar intersection C bar. The set of integer which are not divisible by 3, nor by 5, nor by 7. So if it is divisible, then it is A. So not by A bar, intersection B bar, intersection C bar. Now we can apply De Morgan theorem. So De Morgan law says A union B union C ka bar equal to A bar intersection B bar intersection C bar. Or in general, A union B ka bar equal to A bar intersection B bar. So here, that expression or this expression we can write as a this expression A union B union C bar. So there is a no difference when we have to return in the expression is like that A union B union C ka bar. And A union C union ka bar is nothing but we can find U minus A union B union C. Now, the A union B union C we can just find the value which is 543 and U that is nothing but universal set. What is the total number of integer? It is the 1000. 1000 is the U. So we can just subtract 1000 minus 543. So that is the value we can generate those numbers which are not divisible by 3, nor by 5, nor by 7. So it is the value should be generated as a the value is the 457. So those numbers which are not divisible by 3, nor by 5, nor by 7. So now, the next problem based on the inclusion-exclusion principle is in the survey on group of 80 people, it is found that 60 like X and 30 like fish, find the percentage of people like both fish and egg. So, we can just find E union F, that is 80 people. What is the egg like? How many people? 60 people. 30 people like fish. So mod of f equal to 30. Okay. We can find the percentage of people like both fish and egg. So what we can find? We can find E intersection F upon go. The V of E intersection F we can find and then we can find the percentage of the people. So as we know the formula E union F equal to mod of E plus F minus of E intersection F. E union F is given 80 equal to 60 plus 30 minus E intersection F. Because we can find the percentage of people who like both fish and egg. So now we can just simplify the expression. We can find E intersection F, the value become 10. 60 plus 30, 90, 90 minus 80, it is the 10. So now, that is the value of people, 10 people's out of 80 who will like both fish and egg. Now we can find out the percentage in which we can say how many of the percentage which we like both this thing. So that is we have to find, that is we can just find 80 out of 10 person like, it is called as a 12.5% people like both eggs and fish. Because the value is 10 out of 80 multiplied by 100, so it is nothing but 100 divided by 8. 8 was a 8 to 12. So it is 8 was a 8 to 8 to the 16, 4, and 8 5 is a 40. So 12.5% people likes of the. That is number of percentage in which the person like both eggs and fish. So now, the next problem is that based on the inclusion-exclusion principle, and that is, if the three problem A, B, C have been assigned to a student of class of 80 students, it is found that the 30 students solved A, 40 solved problem B, 50 solved C, 20 students solved both A and B, 25 solved both B and C, and 15 solved both A and C, and 10 students solved all the three problems. Find the number of students who did not solve any problem. So that is also, we can solve based on this concept, n of A union B union C, we can just find the value of n of A. So it is found, the A student can be solved 30 problem, B student n of B, 40 student solved B, and 50 is nothing but n of C equal to 50. So now 20 students solved both A and B. So A intersection B, we can call as a 20 solved both A and B, 25 solved both B and C, and 15 solved both A and C. And 10 students solve all these three problems, A intersection B intersection C equal to, we can just find that is the 10 students solve all the three problems. So now, what we can do, we can just first of all we can find the value of A union B union C, and then we can find the number of students who did not solve any problem. So what we can do, we can just solve n of A union B union C, we can substitute the value of n of A plus n of B plus n of C minus n of A intersection B minus n of B intersection C minus n of A intersection C plus n of A intersection B intersection C. If we substitute the value, it is find 30 plus 40 plus 50 minus 20 minus 25 minus 15 plus 10. So that value, it should become under the form of 70. That value will be generated as a 70. So now we can find out the value of A union B union C bar. So now A union C union B bar, it is nothing but it is equal to U minus A union B union C. So it is the universal value, it is the 80, we can subtract by the 70, that value will be generated as a 10. So find the number of students who did not solve any problem, that is the 10 students who didn't solve any problem. So that's the parts we can discuss about the mathematical induction and inclusion exclusion principle along with the set theory. Thank you.